I just want to show you guys my shirt. Ironically, it was made by my school. It says, eat, sleep, study, repeat. Not even gonna lie to you, it kind of do be like that sometimes.
You say hi, we stay high, you look so pretty, yeah.
So today's video is gonna be about my expectations versus the reality of me entering the International Baccalaureate, or as I like to say, IB program. So I have my trusty notebook given to me by my best friend Namya, who runs the Small Talks podcast, link down below. Definitely give it a listen. And let's get this party started. And so the first expectation is that the IB is insanely hard and that you have to be a genius. So depending on your performance in the International Baccalaureate program, you can actually get credit towards first year university courses. And so because of that, a lot of people think that the IB is this insanely hard program. I watched a video where some girl said that if you aren't a genius, that you shouldn't even bother, and that honestly had me really scared because I had already applied, I was already accepted, and I was set to start in September of last year. So that terrified me, not going to lie. I'd say I was a decent student, but I'm by no means a genius, and so that scared me. IB isn't difficult in terms of content. The content is super comprehensive. You're not going to die, you're not going to fail, you're not going to crash and burn. It's going to be okay. Obviously, there are going to be points that you struggle with. That's the case with every grade, not just I'm doing the diploma program, which is the last 2 years, so grade 11 and 12, it's a 2-year program, but it's just like going into a new grade. It's obviously going to be an increased level of difficulty, but it's nothing that you can't handle. The thing that's difficult to handle with the IB is volume and the amount of assessments that you have to juggle at the same time. It's not the content that's difficult, it's time management and juggling all the different responsibilities that you have within the program. Other than that, you got it. So if you're not getting 100% in every class, don't sweat it. You got it. As long as you stay on top of your things and you ask a lot of questions, you'll be just fine. I'm just gonna let you know that I'm surviving, and coming from me, that's saying something. The next is that IB will murder your social life. That statement can be false, but it can also be true to a certain extent. To what extent? If you know, you know. I just think that if you manage your time well and you get stuff done when you're supposed to, you make time for the things that you love. Obviously, you probably won't have time to do them to the same extent that you're doing before the program. I think to say that the IB takes up all of your time and that your social life will be killed is a bit of an over-exaggeration. I don't know. I find that I'm definitely not exempt from this, but we as IB kids like to exaggerate and make things seem worse than they actually are. I moved schools with my best friend, Namya. You'll hear her name a lot on this channel. But I moved schools with her to do the program. And so we left behind our old friend group. And just because of distance and where we live around the city, it's been increasingly difficult to meet each other. But we always make time. Once every 3 months, I'd say we make time for a hangout. But her and I always hang out at least once a week. We go to the mall for study dates, or we go to each other's house. We are always partners in projects, which makes it super easy to have an excuse to hang out, and you make it work. So if I can do it, you can do it. I cannot say that my social life is dead because of the IB. I'm not even gonna lie, I wasn't even that popping before the IB, so that may be it, but depends on you and what you have going on, so there's that. Next one is the IB will murder your grade. Obviously, it's a little bit more difficult content. It's on a scale from 1 to 7. Instead of getting an 86, you'd be getting a 4 and things like that. Always depends on the student, not gonna lie, but I definitely thought IB would murder my grades. It didn't drop me as much as I thought it was. I'm only experiencing about at most 5% discrepancy between my IB grades and my grades beforehand. So it's not that bad. Do I wish I was doing better? Obviously, but it's not that bad. Ask questions. Your teachers are there for a reason. check out, the IB tells you in plain writing what they expect from you. So if you look at the syllabi, which are available on their website, and look at the different things that they're looking for in their assessments, you should be fine. Also, I'm not saying that you shouldn't try, okay, kids? I'm not saying that you shouldn't try. But technically, nothing really matters until second year when all your testing happens. Your tests are worth, your exams that you take in May of year two, which haven't happened for me yet because I'm in year one, but your exams are worth 80%. And then your IAs, which you write around summer of year one, which is coming up for me, and then the beginning of year two, are worth 20%. When you're applying to universities, which would be for me, around fall of this year, they give you a predicted, and that predicted is based on the work that you do in class. So even though none of your work that you do in class will count towards your IB grade, the work in your class will count towards your predicted, which is what gets you into university. So try your best, kiddies, because it does matter, but it also doesn't, if that makes sense. Like, if you're planning on taking a gap year, I would be like, ooh. I'm kidding. Hi, Mom. Don't kill me. Next and last expectation that I had from IB revolves around TOK and CAS. Everyone hates CAS, but honestly, if you work it into your life and adapt, honestly, it's all about adapting to your new surroundings. I adapted when it came to my social life, and I also adapted when it came to CAS. Doing things that you already do, obviously, there are a couple things. I picked up a couple things here and there, but they were all things that I was interested in anyways. I like to meal prep my lunches, so I cook all my lunches in advance. Obviously, we're in quarantine right now, so I haven't really been doing it lately, so I haven't really been making cast reflections for my meal prep. I meal prep my lunches for the week in advance, and all my snacks and things like that, and so I like to cook, and I like to look up new recipes and try new things. And so that is a perfect thing to use for CAS. I put that under creativity, and it's all in the way you describe it. You can honestly make almost anything a CAS experience if you try hard enough. Obviously, you're thinking cooking. How is that creative? The way that I described it was that I was exploring the culinary arts. Making my lunches for school, CAS reflection right there every week. Done. Things that you already do, I wouldn't go out of my way unless you have absolutely nothing going on, which I probably doubt. You're probably involved in some club, or you do something. If you paint, that can also be creativity. It's all in the way that you describe it and all in the way that you write. So CAS actually isn't that bad. I really enjoy it. The only thing that sucks is just remembering to write reflections, because it's stuff that I do anyways in my day-to-day life. Just remembering to write 3 reflections a week. I usually do 3 reflections every other week, and that's chill. But it used to be that you had to do 50 hours of creativity, 50 hours of action, 50 hours of service, but that's no longer the case. Now it's like, it's no longer an arbitrary number, and they just want to see that you've grown over time. So that's kind of hard to track. So just, I would make things more in your favor by doing as many reflections as possible just to help yourself out. But yeah. And then TOK is theory of knowledge, and the way I would describe it is, it's as if philosophy and psychology had a baby, and it's honestly one of my favorite classes. Everyone hates it and make fun of TOK for some reason. They think, I'll insert the many entertaining IB memes. But I honestly love TOK. I think that's partially in contribution by my teacher, Mr. Y. If you're watching this, you are like one of my favorite teachers. You make the subject so interesting. But yeah, TOK is honestly so interesting. It depends on your class, it depends on your teacher, but a lot of people hate TOK. And I thought that TOK was stupid from the description, because it's like, the way that the IB describes TOK is why we know what we know. So that can sound kind of redundant and kind of stupid. And honestly, I thought walking into it, I was gonna hate it, but it's honestly great. I am a humanities kid, so stuff like that deals with the human condition and society, we live in a society, and people and stuff like that just makes my brain happy. But that is all for today. I definitely hope to film more school and IB related content, so just let me know what you'd like to know. I'm fast approaching the end of my first year in the program, so definitely look out for a video on my review of first year in IB. But that is it for today. And I will catch you, hopefully, in the next one. Bye.